Welcome back to the Michael Brooks Show. Joining us now is friend of show and a person that I have no doubt that who you know who he is. He's author most recently of a collection of essays which you can get as an ebook through OrBooks called Pandemic, COVID-19 Shakes the World. Slavoj Zizek, thank you for joining us over questionable technology from Slovenia to Brooklyn.
Thanks very much. You know what happened with this technology in Singapore? They used it for teaching in elementary schools, but somebody hacked it and put pornographic images into it, so they prohibited it.
Oh, that's not just Singapore. Happening everywhere. Oh my God! Yes, absolutely. The chat roulette days are back. Slavoj, what about? Let's just talk very broadly first. You have been someone who's always focused a lot on the commons, which I think is very important in terms of understanding where we are. When you look at the bailouts and the sort of consolidations that are coming, particularly in the United States, what do you think see as the long-term economic consequences of the pandemic?
Well, things are in very sad sense pretty ironic now. Conservative politicians are doing things which if left democratic politicians were to do, he would be accused of introducing communism or whatever and so on and so on. Boris Johnson temporarily nationalized the British railways. Trump is now invoking that Cold War law which allows him to give direction to run industry and so on and so on, all that stuff. So obviously, as even such a guy who he admits it, he admires capitalism, like Bill Gates, he wrote in a recent short comment that obviously markets cannot do the job. You need a whole set of measures which, and I don't use this, what I will say now, for praising communism and so on. We will enter, if you ask me, and again, I'm not glad about it. It will be a sad period. A period of, unfortunately, what I cannot call but wartime communism. More communism of misery. What do I mean by this? Isn't it clear that in order for our societies to more or less survive in an orderly way, you have to take care or the state together with people and so on, you have to guarantee that some basic things will function. Not only healthcare for all, and even Bill Gates admits it here. Healthcare must be global healthcare. You cannot have United States relatively safe and across the border pandemics and so on. We need some kind of a, not only a universal healthcare within singular state, but some kind of global healthcare system which coordinates the efforts and so on. This means scientific research collaboration. This means a coordination of who is producing respirators, masks, all that stuff and so on. But this is not all. Next thing, now, and this is almost a touching, I almost cried Marxist moment for me, how we became aware of how false the formula lockdown is. Are we aware how many people whom we simply didn't notice have to go on working so that we can be, nobody is really safe, relatively safe in our isolated apartments, food delivery, electricity, trash, healthcare and so on. Lockdown is an option for a privileged minority. Look at the situation in India, where they tried to do a lockdown and it turned ridicule. Because what about, we are talking, I read, about millions of people who simply in big cities like Mumbai, New Delhi, didn't even have a home. They simply were selling something on the street. They were sleeping there in a corner. So what does it mean, go home for them? Not to mention, of course, all the millions of refugees all about Middle East and at other places. They cannot self-isolate. They don't have a place where to isolate and so on. So this is the first thing. This is now, and here markets cannot do the job. We cannot say, oh, do we have enough money for this? No, we have to think in different terms. Our societies are developed enough to produce healthcare equipment, enough food, and so on, but we will have to organize it. And I don't know how this will work in the United States. In Europe, since spring is here, there is already, in most of European states, developed states, Germany, France, even in my state, Slovenia, a big problem. Spring harvest is approaching. We were all relying on immigrant guest workers from other less developed parts, like, I don't know, hundreds of thousands of people from Spain and southern Italy came to France and so on. Now, because there is a lockdown, they cannot do it. How to do it? Up to a point, you can do it with volunteers. But food provision is crucial. Who knows? Maybe some kind of almost wartime mobilization will be needed. Young people who are now unemployed and so on will have to be literally mobilized. So, and then another thing, this is one of the few bright spots. What people from Latin America, from Spain, and even from southern Italy, my links there are telling me, how all those organizations that we usually like to dismiss as simply crime organizations proved quite efficient. For example, do you know in Sicily who is now distributing freely food to the poor? Of course, probably with their own calculation. It's mafia. Yep. And the most beautiful thing, it almost made me cry. You know, a friend from Rio de Janeiro wrote to me, you know, in favelas there, gangs who are usually fighting for the territory, they concluded peace and are organizing help for destitute lone people there and so on and so on. So my point is what? My point is now almost everybody is, that's my irony, not even a socialist, but almost a communist. They admit it. We need international cooperation, real cooperation, because again, you cannot have one side of the border epidemics, the other side is safe. We need efficient state, which if necessary breaks all the rules of the market and so on, just to deliver. These are matters of survival. And in Spain, I was told, there were beautiful moments how in local communities, people self-organized, you know. It's almost like, I think, in Cuba, and I'm not a believer in Castro, but they still have these, how do they call them, local committees of revolution, which take care of the law. Now they're re-emerging in Italian, Spanish cities, but in a positive way. People simply ask, okay, who are the old people who live alone in our block? What can we do for them? And so on and so on. But I, on the other hand, it's a dangerous moment. Every politician is already.
Well, Zizek, I want to, Slavoj, real quick, I want to just inject two things into this that are important.
I'm very sorry. You have
no.
Full right to interrupt me. I talk too much. Yes?
We love you talking, and I have a full right to interrupt. So it's a dialectic. So
Comrade Stalin would be proud of you.
This is the highest praise of Stalin through you. But this also reminds me of this book that came out called The People's Republic of Walmart, How the World's Largest Corporation Are Laying the Foundation of Socialism. And this is actually something I want you to expand on first. The idea that in the complexity and the centralization of those supply chains that you see at something like Walmart, actually debunks the idea that like, oh, no, it could never be that central. It could never work like that. It needs to be kind of more horizontal and so on. It shows that in certain ways you can plan like that, but it's not being planned in a democratic direction. It's being planned in the Walmart direction, which loops back to your point.
Yes, absolutely agree with you. And I'm well aware how dangerous also the situation is for new forms of corruption here.
Yes.
I don't blame capitalists as persons, but such a situation solicits corruption. So I'm here very realist. I am for these necessary communist measures. By communist measures, don't be afraid. I don't mean Central Committee will run United States, but I mean, almost, and this is a cruel irony in what I'm saying now, I mean almost what Trump is doing now, and Trump is not my, when he says we need so many respirators, masks, and so on, giving orders to industry. But this has to be done in a transparent way, you know, which is my formula. When a journalist asks me what kind of a communism I imagine, and I answered him, communism with Julian Assange. Like somebody like Assange, yes. This is what China is missing. I am not pro-Chinese. And now I will tell you something for which now many people who thought, I'm now praising China, total control, they did it. You know, no. There are good reasons that if the Chinese wouldn't miss at the very beginning of December, the first weeks, it would just have remained a local epidemic there. Second...
But real quick, I mean, I want to tease that out, though, because how do you connect that Trump is bullshitting a lot of this? So, like, he says we should do defense production, but he's not actually doing it. He's letting them price gouge. Where is the gap between the rhetoric, which Trump actually does very well at times, but it's not getting implemented as one lane? Then there's the other, and maybe we could connect this with China. You've warned us, and we've talked before about the idea of the Singapore world, that everywhere will kind of turn into a kind of platform surveilled capitalism. And then the third thing that you're talking about, which is maybe this opening to reject the market logic. Do you see those three? I see those three horizons. I see the Trump bullshit artistry, and we're price gouging, and we're doing Reaganism here, which is why it's such a disaster. Then I see people being drawn to an authoritarian narrative that has efficacy. So China's very complicated, and I think we need to critique where China has clearly failed and not been transparent. And then on the other hand, they're building hospitals in a matter of days. The world is going to look at that with a lot of admiration. But and then know, is there a social response?
Yeah, but I will give you now Now, I will sound horrible, some leftist will lynch me for saying this, but why, as if the alternative is China or Trump? Let's look at, okay, Singapore made a mistake because they opened up too fast. Now, it's growing a little bit, but it's sad to say this, but the countries which did it correctly, I think, are, and that's why China doesn't want them mentioned, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and South Korea.
South Korea, yeah.
South Korea, they did it. I don't know. I don't want to be a racist. Is it their tradition of social discipline and so on? But look at Hong Kong, the ferocious demonstrations that went on for months, for half a year before the epidemics, proved that they certainly are not in their nature totalitarian, but nonetheless, they did it in an organized way. So Korea, look at Korea and so on. Look at Taiwan. So it can be done. It can be done. But the basic thing is here also now I'll say something sad for some of the leftists. We from the left should, this is the motive I always repeat. We from the left should, we need an efficient state now. No, we should maybe not becoming obsessed with this Giorgio Agamben motif, those in power will use this as a tool of new totalitarian control. Probably they will try, but you know, what is my main counter argument? And those in power are aware of it. It's not we ordinary people who are terrorized by them. They are in a panic. They don't know how to solve it. They are under test. What I fear almost more is that the people's trust into authority will be undermined. But we need now some kind of functioning government authority which people trust at least minimally. And from what I hear in the United States, okay, it's not as simple as that. Trump talks a lot, but things are happening at different level. Governors in some states try to be more efficient and so on and so on. So now we can see how Trump is not an efficient central leader. No, he talks too much. He is not enough of an efficient leader.
Just watched a Michael Brooks Show video. Subscribe to get them all. Why wouldn't you? Don't be foolish. Click subscribe below and become a patron as well. Patreon.com/TMBS. Thanks, everybody.